All right, you guys, we're gonna get the show on the road here. I got 2 hours to get this thing, and I want to make sure that everybody has a chance to say whatever they want to say. I want everybody to have that opportunity, so I want to get going here. For those of you who may not know who I am, I'm sure that you all do, but my name is George Wilson. I am still the current chairman of the board for the Villages at Mount Hood Board of Directors. Let everybody know this is not a Villages board meeting. It's not a Villages town hall. It was made very clear to me by the county that I could not function, or that we couldn't function under the auspices of the Villages board. I did send an invitation for county commissioners and county staff to show up. I received an email from Katie Wilson, who is the public involvement specialist with Clackamas County, and said, thank you for the notice and invitation. You as a member of our community are welcome to conduct a town hall meeting to discuss issues of interest. However, as the Villages at Mount Hood board is still on hiatus, it's not possible to meet in an official board of directors capacity. Additionally, no county funds or equipment can be made available for this meeting. At this time, I do not believe any staff or county commissioners will be attending. I will contact you if I become aware of any changes or additional information regarding this matter. I want everybody to think about that for a minute. What we're meeting here for today is I just want to clear up what's been going on for the past year since we've been in this mess. Let me get back to my agenda here, guys. Excuse me. I want to introduce a few people that have been with me through this since the beginning. Carol Burke, back in the back, who is still an active director for the Villages Board. She's been with me the whole time, has been by my side. Carol and I actually nominated, according to our bylaws, we ended up nominating a couple of interim positions in order to have a quorum. However, the county refused to recognize them because we are technically in a hiatus. Those two people were Kirk Robinson, sitting here in front of me here. Kirk Robinson, he's been with me the whole time and has been supporting our community and this issue. The other one we nominated was Pat Holbrook. Pat Holbrook is a friend of mine and a longstanding member of this community. I'm proud to know Pat. He's a Purple Heart recipient, and everybody here in the community knows who he is, and he's been with us as well. Pat actually went with us to the mediation process. We ended up going, set up a mediation process with Clackamas County. Carol went with me. My attorney, Gary Linkus, was there. Pat Holbrook went with us to this mediation process as well, and had some very interesting things to say and was very helpful. So I just want to say thank you to you guys for hanging in there with me. This has been a very tumultuous year, to say the least. But I appreciate you guys being there with me. Now, he's on vacation. He couldn't be here. I told him to take off and not think twice about what was going on here in the Villages. But he did give me a statement, and I want to read that to you guys now. It says, to all of you in the Mount Hood Villages community, thank you for joining this discussion about our future representation with Clackamas County. While I'm not sure how we reached this point, there appears to have been dissension among board members as well as frustration in the community regarding how projects were managed. Some board members resigned, and all attempts, including mediation, to put the board back together have failed. The county labeled the village's board fractured and ineffective, which makes sense because they imposed a hiatus that suspended the board activity indefinitely. In whatever form it takes, we need to be represented in county planning and government. There are so many local projects that need our attention and support. Although I can't be at this meeting, I urge all my friends and neighbors in these villages to demand inclusion in the planning and future of our community. So that was Pat Holbrook, and I hope he's enjoying his vacation. I know he is. Okay. By looking out in the audience, I don't think that we're going to have much in the way of any dissension or anybody being out of order. I'm glad to see that so far we've remained calm. And I thank you for that because obviously the county is looking for anything to nullify what we're trying to do tonight. But what we're here for is Clackamas County has decided that rather than abide by our current bylaws and abide by current county code, they are trying to find ways around dealing with existing rules and regulations to dissolve our village's board. Now, I was listening to a policy session, Clackamas County policy session last week. There was a lot of discussion about this, and I guess the message was made clear to them by their county council, Stephen Matkauer, that dissolution is going to be a very difficult process the way it's written. And it should be, because that's our bylaws and county code. All they have to do is just follow the same rules that we follow. And that's all I've ever asked from Clackamas County. I've been a director with the village's board now for, I believe it's about 8 years. My first term I did as an interim board member, and that was for 2 years, I believe, as an interim. I then was elected a director full-time, and then did 2 terms. So it's been about 8 years I've been sitting on this board. So I've seen how things function, and to be honest, I was just getting very frustrated with the county's lack of involvement. This all started out because I approached the county and asked them to uphold their end of the bargain here with regard to how we were dealt with. I had made repeated attempts and requests for county presence at our town halls and at specific board meetings. And each time, it was to no avail. We didn't get county representation. So I made several trips down to Clackamas County to have a meeting with Gary Schmidt about this. And I was told that our liaison at the time, Barbara Smolak, was retired in waiting. And that she implied that her hands were full with CPO meetings and didn't have time to come up and deal with us here on the mountain. So we were void of county representation at several meetings, and I was getting upset about this. So in December, we have elections, and it's county's responsibility to oversee our elections. Barbara Smolak didn't show up, but instead sent an individual, an employee from the Water and Environmental Services District, the services, to come up and oversee our official town hall elections. He had never overseen an election or never had anything to do with it. He was up here asking me what he should do, and I was trying to brief him while I was setting up, but either way, we did not have a liaison. We had somebody from the Water Environmental Services over here overseeing our elections. We subsequently had the elections, and there were two people who went to the board, or went to the BCC, complaining that they witnessed individuals taking more than one ballot. Now, that's fine and dandy. However, there was no effort on the county's behalf to come and talk to me as the board chair. Nobody talked to our other two directors who were overseeing the ballots and making sure that everybody had driver's licenses and that everybody were residents. To this day, we have never had a forum to where we can talk to our community and express our concerns and refute any of the assertions or allegations that were lodged against me as a director. So, again, I at my expense, I ended up having an attorney, and we ended up going down and mediating this. And our mediation, I gotta walk around here, guys, while I talk. Our mediation, I thought, was quite successful after we finished up. We were very optimistic walking out of the room. County staff agreed with us. We had a signed MOU, a signed memorandum of understanding. It was the county's suggestion that the BCC accept this memorandum of understanding. And despite our agreement and county suggestions, the county staff suggestion, the BCC decided to strike down the agreement and decided that they were still going to try to proceed with dissolution. So that was my my second or third attempt to try to get this thing back up and running and get back on track. Everything that we've done up to this point has been futile. And so that's kind of where it goes. I've never asked anything more from the county than what they promised us. And because I've been very persistent and very diligent dealing with county staff on this, I know that the BCC is upset at the fact that I've come after, not come after, but I've been very vocal with county staff in the way that we've been mistreated here. So I've got all of my emails, we've got everything on record here on what's going on, but either way, we're now at a point now where BCC has decided that dissolution is not going to be in their best interest. But now what they've decided to do is change county code, Clackamas County Ordinance, so that it makes it easier for the BCC to arbitrarily remove elected officials. So essentially, Clackamas County is controlling our advisory group to the county. And the last time, I'm sorry? I'm going to get to all you guys. I'm going to make sure I'm going to pass this mic around so that everybody has something to say.
My question involves what you're talking about. Describe BCC.
The BCC is the Board of County Commissioners. We have five commissioners, as you can see.
They could care less about us.
Well represented.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm really quite surprised about this because the BCC, and they understand what they're doing, but in policy sessions, they've decided that in order to dissolve the board, they have to They are required to have a public meeting, a public town hall for the community. They want to hold that meeting in Oregon City. And it'll be during the week, and it'll be at 9:00 in the morning. And this is how the BCC works. So I am a little rebellious right now. I've been through the mill with these guys, and I am adamant as a elected official from this community to stand up for our rights as a community. Last I checked, I'm an American. I have these rights, and so do you. And so I wanted to make everybody aware of where we're at with this. And if anybody has any questions, I'm certainly willing to entertain those, but I want you to hold on to them right now. I got a few people that I'd like to introduce and that want to speak. And first on my list, I know, Carol, you as a director, you had a few things that you wanted to say. So come on up and take the mic for a minute.
Thank you, George, for the explanation.
Yeah, and if anybody has any questions, if I'm not clear, please don't be afraid to ask. You don't want to stand in front of that.
Well, thank you all for coming tonight. It's important that we all get a clear and concise explanation of what's going on. I know it's been very confusing for a lot of people. I think it's been very confusing for a lot of people as to what's really happening. And the bottom line is there was a couple individuals on the board that were dissatisfied with the way the board was being handled. And instead of working it out, going through mediation and working it out amongst ourselves as a community, they chose to take matters into their own hands. And that is the result of what's going on right now. So my take on it is I saw the board from its conception. I saw the troubles and things, the hiccups as we went along. And it was finally in a good place where things were actually getting done for this community. And it would be a really big loss for us at this point to let this board be dissolved. I think there's a lot of caring people in this community that want to see things move forward. And that's pretty much all I have to say. Either you are for the board to keep it going and to get things accomplished in this community, or you're not. And I hope that all of the drama and the misrepresentation on my part and Marilyn, I have to put Marilyn in there too, because we were kind of thrown under the bus. We joined the board with the intention of helping do something to bring this community together and get some things done. And I'd like to see that still happen. Thank you.
Thanks, Carol. Yeah, that's another thing I should mention too, is that, we volunteer for this job. We're not paid to put up with all this nonsense. We do it voluntarily. I moved here. I had brown hair, man. Not anymore. But okay, I'd like to also introduce a good friend of mine, and he was our first village's chairman, our board chairman, Rick Applegate. Where's Rick? There he is. Rick, come on up. Now, I should say,
slow down,
Rick, because the last time Rick was here at one of my town halls, man, he ended up with a heart attack.
So I just want to make sure it's still ticking.
Okay. All right. Rick Applegate.
Thanks, George. Hey, this is hard work. Any time that politics are involved, it's hard work. And I think we've seen that, a lot of us out there have seen over the last number of years how hard it really has been to build this organization and keep it going. I wanted to provide some historical perspective and a couple of thoughts as the chair who kind of kicked this whole thing off. You know, really about 2004, I believe, might have been 2005, we started meeting as the Strategic Planning Committee here on the mountain. It was everybody in the community, the faith-based organizations. Faith-based organizations were there. The women's club was there, the seniors, the businesses were represented. Everybody was there. And what we needed to accomplish was we needed some sort of plan for the community. We were not successful in getting grants to support community projects and to do other things without a community strategic plan. And we had a couple of things that we really needed to accomplish up here. And so in the process over a year, year and a half, we realized that we had to also have an organization. So everybody put their heads together and we determined that we wanted a county service district. We wanted a service district of some sort. And it was the county that told us, please don't do that. We're working on an ordinance. It's called the Villages and Hamlets Ordinance. And it's going to really be a unique platform for you to be able to do these things. So you can attract grants and you can get the monies to support some of the community programs. And you're going to be the eyes and ears for the commissioners. You're going to be the people on the front end that are detailing and explaining and sharing your community's needs and perspectives to the commissioners. So that's how we got started. I'm telling you, it wasn't easy. Steve Graber's back there shaking his head. I mean, we met in 2006, myself, Bob Reeves, Dave Lithgow, Don Mintz, Shirley Duber, Steve Graber, Susan Corwin, did I say Shirley Duber? Yeah. And on Shirley Duber and my birthday on the 25th of May in 2006, we became a village. And we were out there and it was a really great time. Commissioner Kenemer, Commissioner Schrader, Commissioner Schroeder, Schrader and Commissioner Soa, Larry Soa, they embraced this, they designed it, and they helped us launch this whole thing. I want to tell you how hard those commissioners worked at that time to at least support the village's concept. Every year, every commissioner came up to our community. Times have changed, folks.
Yeah.
Times have changed. They came up every single year. We briefed them on what we've been doing. We briefed them on the work that we were doing. We briefed them on what we needed support from them. And I remember a couple of times Bill Kenemer going like, pointing out to his staff saying, I want answers for this. Give me some answers. It wasn't easy. Man, we all risk relationships with our friends in the community. We all risked a lot to get this off the ground. And every board member, and there have been dozens over the last decade, have risked to try and serve their community. You might not agree with what they did, and you might not agree with how they did it, but every single one of them were risking a lot. They risked their businesses, they risked their relationships, and we see in the end that a lot of us, a lot of these folks on these boards overcame all of those obstacles to remain friends and support each other in a lot of different ways. But it's hard work. And when you see these folks like George and Carol and Kurt and they want to step up and they want to serve the community and they want to do it, whether you agree with all of what they got to sell you, you got to support them. Because they do a lot of work for really not anything. Something changed a few years ago. I mean, it wasn't just those three original commissioners. We had Commissioner Austin, Ann Leinecker, Lynn Peterson, Jamie Damon. I mean, all of these commissioners came in and they all supported us in the same exact way. They came up here, they sat down with us. They used to call us when there was going to be something in a work session. And they say, you guys need to be down here on Tuesday. You get 30 seconds. Yeah, but it was 30 seconds, folks. So here we are. Current Board of County Commissioners want to dissolve our community governance board. And I'd like to point out a couple of things after listening to the tape that I find to be extremely poor reasoning.
What tape?
The tape of the policy session on, it's available to everybody. Listen to it. It will blow your mind. You really need to listen to this. Do you know the date of that policy session? It was a couple weeks ago.
Well, it was just a recent one, too.
It was a recent one.
Yeah.
They said that no longer did they need the villages at Mount Hood because there's adequate communications and representation from our community.
Because Bernard comes up and hangs out.
Absolutely. So, and I want to know who this person is, okay?
Yeah.
Who is this, you know? What's this organization that's adequately communicating? I mean, I know that probably the most active most active community organization is the Rhododendron CPA. Chair's sitting right there, okay? They communicate, they do a great job, they have a robust board, there's this phenomenal people that are serving on it. But that is an organization that serves a very small minority in the community. It doesn't represent Brightwood, it doesn't represent Welch's, it doesn't represent Wemmy, it doesn't represent Wildwood. And so that can't be it, as much as I trust Steve and I would trust that board to do that. Those aren't the folks. Outside of that, all we have are membership organizations. Pay-to-play membership organizations. None of them are designed to represent the community. They're designed to represent their membership, their paying membership. So who is this person that those commissioners said is the person that is providing that excellent communication? The second thing, you know, and in that, I want to know, I mean, who, other than the village's board, if we have a transportation issue, if we have a community infrastructure issue, if we have another flood down Lolo Pass that ruins the road, who's fighting for this community? We may not like some of the projects, or we may love some of the projects that are going on, but somebody there has to be, it isn't if we can communicate, or it isn't if we are communicating, the question is, can we communicate with Clackamas County Commissioner? And without the village's board, I'm telling you, we have no real way to communicate. They said that election was flawed. And I'm going to digress just a little bit. And I want to support what George said about the support for the, not just for that election, but the county has overseen our elections for a long time. And I'm telling you, it is absolutely hilarious to me that they take issue with this election, with that election. In 2009, we had an election that was absolutely blatantly manipulated by the county commission, by Clackamas County. Okay? They didn't check the voter rolls coming in. They didn't check IDs. They gave ballots to non-citizens, not people that don't live in our community. They picked two people from our community to help count the votes. And they refused to let them see the votes. The county liaison called out the name that they were supposed to make tally marks and then sealed them and put them away. They did that for 30 to 40 minutes. Every 30 to 40 minutes, they retallied. They added the new votes. And 1 hour before the polls were to close, she came up to the board member and said, "You're out, you're one short. I'm closing the polls." And when she was asked by somebody who's here in the community, in this room right now, not me, when she was asked by them and said, "Hey, it's an hour beforehand," the county liaison said, "It's 1 o'clock by my watch," and walked away. That, Those are the folks that are telling us that we can't run an election right. I just have a problem with the lack of respect for the democratic process. This is our decision. And if this group doesn't want to have a village's board, doesn't want to have a village organization, I'm okay with that. I personally am going to vote for it. I want us to stay around. It's been too many people work too hard with some really positive things that have happened and can happen. But the democratic process is important, folks. Okay, it's our choice. They created the rules. We're living by them. And we want to leverage that so that the community can be successful. So what happens if we're not a village anymore? You know, it's my own personal opinion. I think we have no safety net to address community concerns. Have no way to address transportation, housing, infrastructure. Right now we have some serious problems with housing up here. Areas growing, we have no low-income housing. Did you know that if you wanted to build 12, 15 apartment build out up here, that you would have to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars in development charges to the county? And you'd have to put up a couple hundred thousand dollars of your own money before you could get the permit to go to the bank. Hundreds of thousands of dollars just to build on your own property. So who up here is going to be building for apartments and other housing needs that we have? It'll be people from the outside that will come up here. This is the first year in over a decade that during an election cycle we have not had a candidate for them. It was the villages that brought that to this community. Every single election cycle, every single one of those people that aren't here today, they've all put their tail ends in a warm seat up here and face the community. They don't have to anymore if we're not a village. And it'll go back to the way it was. We will not, we weren't relevant. But with the village's board, with the village's organization in this community, we were relevant. And all the candidates came up here and faced the community. And we all got to ask them questions. So the other thing too that we forget sometimes is that we were created by the county commissioners to be their eyes and ears. That relationship has to be repaired. For us to be successful, we need a great relationship with our commissioners. If we function well with them, we're going to function well as a community. And so without this organization, we certainly won't see that community to commissioner relationship and develop in any meaningful way. And I think that if they do dissolve this board against this community's wishes, it will set them back a long way up here in this community. And we'll go back to a time, you know, in this community where only the people with close relationships with the commissioners are calling the shots. That's the way it used to be done. You can never take that out 100%, but that's the way it will be in the future. So anyways, my recommendation, I don't want to see the village's board dissolve. I think we've worked too hard. I'm just going to lay it out there. I think that these commissioners dislike George so much, they're willing to blow up our community. Okay? And I just got to shoot from the hip, okay? If George weren't here, I don't think they'd ever come in and try to do this. George and I, we have our differences. But I'll tell you what, he's always been honest with me. He's always had my back. And I'll always have George's back. and we will disagree on a lot of things.
And that's okay.
But that's okay, because that's what it's all about. And finally, I just want you to, I want to point out again, look at the empty seats. You know, thank you, Mark, for coming up here. Thank you. This is the way it's been for the last couple of years, and thank God that we have a representative like Mark Johnson who supports our community. And that's all I got.
Thank you, Rick. And I appreciate the comments.
Thank you.
So, hang on, you're taking my... I'm not in agreement with the Republican view, but I support Mark Johnson. Mark Johnson has always been here for us. I've seen Mark at many of these functions.
I'm wrapped around the podium here, guys.
I've seen Mark here at many of these functions, and he does take a deep interest in what's going on with us here at the Villages, and I'm a firm believer that politics starts at the local level. So I want to introduce Mark, and I want to thank you, Mark, for showing up. This is huge for me and for the Villages. I really appreciate your support, and I want to turn this over to you now so that you can say a few things.
Take your advice, and I won't stand in front of it.
Thank you. It's great to be here. I didn't have a lot of advance notice for this event tonight. Five. Had another engagement on the calendar, but this is a lot more fun. So, if you knew what the other was, you'd understand. So, I sent staff to cover for me there, so that's fine. But I do always enjoy getting up here. I mean, I've always wanted to get up here. I love local communities like the Villages. That's just part of a special district that I represent, you know, from Brightwood to Boring to Bridalveil. You know, every one of these are different communities with different people, different needs, different passions. And there's nothing I enjoy more than sitting down and actually talking with folks and so forth about what it is that I can do for them or what their needs are. So, yeah, but my purpose here is not to get in the midst of, you know, to get down in the weeds. I'm not trying to be George. There's not enough Kevlar in the world to be like another George here. But I am here to listen to you all so I can better understand, you know, what your thoughts are about this situation so that I can learn. That's what my job is, so I can listen and learn so that I can better represent you, as I hopefully will have opportunity to talk to some of these folks who have chosen not to be here tonight, but also at the legislative level. And this is where I get, and Rick touched on this, and he's exactly right. You know, the lack of representation that you have, or I'll just say that you don't currently have with your county commission can hurt, well, let's just say it doesn't help you get your place at the table in Salem, okay? Because we're going to be considering some big issues in the next session. Transportation is one of them. And these opportunities don't come along very often. When was the last time the state of Oregon, you know, had a comprehensive transportation package? It's been a long time. So it's important that whatever your needs are, that there's somebody other than me, the county commissioner, would be ideal to be advocating for whatever it is. And I don't know what those needs are. You guys know, you know, we've obviously done some work on 26 and so forth that's being improved, but there could be other things. But you've got to have your place at the table to get your piece of the pie. Because in a transportation package that the whole state buys into, everybody's going to get something. So that's just the reality of it. Economic development. What else can we be doing to foster and encourage greater economic development up here? Or what can we do to get out of the way so that you guys can be more successful? Because sometimes, frankly, the state is a deterrent to your success rather than an asset. Natural resources, you know, what else can we do to help you manage your resources to make sure they're preserved and protected and so that people can come here and engage in recreation and all kinds of other, you know, pursuits and so forth. But, you know, at the end of the day, though, I think from my perspective, you know, this is taxation without representation. There's, think about the amount of dollars that flow from this community in transient lodging taxes and gas tax and everything else that goes back to Oregon City, I don't see a lot of that coming back up here. And that, to me, seems sad. I mean, that really is sad. Frankly, you just need eyes and ears that are committed to you. So again, I'm not here to cast aspersions on people. I'll let their, you know, presence or lack thereof speak for itself. But I'm just here to listen and learn, and again, to learn how I can better represent you, so I can have a better, rather than getting reports third hand, it's much better for me to hear with my own ears, you know, what your feelings are and stuff. So I'm just here to be a fly on the wall, but I'll be sitting right over here, George, in my lonely seat. I'll turn it back to you, so thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. And I'm not going to make you sit there all night if you want to go on. More than welcome. Sorry, guys. I'm so sorry for stepping in front of that. That's one of the problems with this.
I didn't do that.
I know you didn't. I have a PA system in my closet.
Aren't you a sound guy?
But we weren't able to use it because it's county equipped. So I'm left with this. I do want to. We're right on target here, so that's great. Clackamas County did a very similar thing with the Moala Prairie Hamlet. I received a phone call from the chair of that hamlet, which is also now in hiatus. And I want to read Susan's email. Her name is Susan Hansen.
Is that what they call it, hiatus for them, or they're totally dissolved?
Yeah. Well, no, they're on hiatus. They're trying to dissolve that board as well. But either way, I'm going to read this email that I got from Susan. And after my experience with Clackamas County and the spin that they chose to put on this was astounding to me. And reading the papers after my last board, our last board meeting, Jim Bernard indicated that we allowed drugs and alcohol into the meeting.
Hear, hear.
Yeah, there was another comment from John Ludlow that I had commented many times that I didn't know how to lead. That was never said. What I did say was that I had never been a chairman before, and that it wasn't rocket science, and I had all of the information that schooled me up on what being a chairman entailed. But either way, I want to read this email from Susan Hansen, and she describes basically what they went through. It says, "Hello, George. I was chair of the hamlet of Moala Prairie, and we were planning an election when Commissioner Tootie Smith, publicly slammed me and asked Moala mayor to gather slam letters from city business people. I checked with the Kafori law firm and might have had a defamation case, but since I was part of a nonprofit called Bear Creek Recovery that was starting a pro bono lawsuit against the city of Moala, I put the needs of the Clean Water Act lawsuit ahead of my potential defamation case. We did finally fight to get our election, and we were all elected, but after a couple of months, we as a board all resigned since we would not work with the BCC that had such disregard for the community, for our community elections. If I can help in any way with your lawsuit, please get in touch. I have no fear of going on record about what they did to me and the hamlet here. Tootie, Ludlow, and Martha Schrader all are on policy session recording slamming me and the hamlet because I've spoken out politically against all three of them. I have the email that Tootie sent to the Moala mayor, which is attached, and it says, cut off the snake at the head and tail. She needs these emails by Monday evening and lists the slate of our candidates. Most had long ago been vetted and had already served as board members for years. Most were founding members of the hamlet. I think this could help show a pattern of defamation and abuse by the BCC against political opponents. I also have a collection of letters that Tootie got the mayor to gather, obtaining them via public record request. They attempt to make it sound like the Hamlet and I were responsible for the pitiful mess that is Moala. Tootie and the BCC could not even understand the difference between a land use appeal the Hamlet sponsored and the actual lawsuit Bear Creek Recovery filed against the city. I want you to be sure to find the policy sessions where they meddled in our election and personally attacked me in the spring of 2014. It, I think, shows a pattern of abuse given your problems with the villages. The Hamlet of Moala Prairie had a website and a Facebook page. We held monthly meetings for Republic and monthly board meetings. All was well as long as Chris Roth was working with us. Then they fired Chris Roth. Then Amy Kyle started coming to these meetings. Amy Kyle is the strategic communications officer with Clackamas County. Our board voted to fund an appeal of a totally illegal Moala land use hearing that Hamlet citizens requested. And we have that in writing. And we spent $600. Amy Kyle sat in on that meeting and raised no objections. Nothing was said. And the developer didn't follow through, so it became a dead issue. Gary Schmidt, Director of Public and Government Affairs, said not to do it again, but there was nothing the county was going to do. Then the Bear Creek Recovery lawsuit was filed. Many of us were on that Hamlet board. And shit hit the fan, that's what she says. The city manager went whining to Gary Schmidt, and that's when they all went crazy. I think they were so ignorant, they thought our board was funding the BCR lawsuit with Hamlet money, which was totally not true. So Gary Schmidt lied to us. I have it in writing where Gary indicated nothing would be said about the $600 appeal. The city of Moala would not refund the money even though there was no appeal. We ended up using donated money to pay back the $600. However, that still was not enough to stop the witch hunt on our Hamlet board elections. That was from Susan Hansen, the chair of the now hiatus, it's on hiatus, just like our village board is. So, there's a pattern here, guys, and we have a problem with a few of our directors, a few of the commissioners that are sitting on the commission. I want to mention here as well, I was fortunate enough to come across some information here with regard to the amount of money that Clackamas County has spent on lawsuits. And the total is $3,486,740. These are generally stemmed by Commissioner John Ludlow and Commissioner Tootie Smith. So there's a lot of money. It's a lot of money in lawsuits. There is no mistake that I am the individual that Clackamas County refers to as rogue. And I just want to reiterate one more time, all I've been trying to do is get Clackamas County to hear us, to listen to us, to abide by the rules and the regulations that we have to follow. As it turns out now, they have chosen not to follow those rules and are trying to rewrite those rules. So here's where we're at. It's important, and as Rick had mentioned before, we can have disagreements, and we're supposed to. We're not all going to agree on everything, but what I'm fighting for, and what I want you guys to stand up for, is for our right to sit at the table and to have those discussions. That's the way it's done. I don't know any other way to do it. Any other way is not a participatory government. It's a dictatorship. And as I said before, I live in this country, I'm an American, and we have rights. and I'm exercising those rights. And I want you guys to as well. So that's pretty much all I have to say at this point. I'd like to turn it over to the audience. If anybody has any questions, I would certainly love to entertain them. Or if you have any questions for anybody else, Mark Johnson or Rick or anybody else.
Yeah.
And can I get you guys to come up and use the mic?
I just have a quick question.
I know. But listen, we're on film now, and I would like everything that you guys have to say to be recorded.
My question is just, where do we go from here? What do we do? Where do we go? What's the plan? If you could kind of explain some of that.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I have a document that sat on these tables back here that people can sign if they are opposed to the BCC's Board of County Commissioners' plans to move forward with the dissolution process. Also on that document is we've highlighted the fact that we are opposed to commission changing county code, rewriting the rules, so to speak. So our goal is to send a very clear message to the BCC that our community is opposed to the dissolution process. We value our board and we want to keep it. So the only way that we're going to be able to accomplish that is by public involvement. Obviously, you know, this is a battle. There's no question. This is a battle between me and four commissioners. I didn't mention it at the beginning of the meeting, but I do want to say that Commissioner Paul Savas has been behind us the whole way. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Paul Savas has supported this board. He has supported our opportunities for due process. And that's all I've ever asked. I just want to have our opportunity. So this is the first time that I've had a chance to address the villages, residents from the villages on this issue. So I'm upset at the county staff at not giving us that opportunity. I'm upset at county staff for Gary Schmidt, not reconsidering his decision to invalidate our elections based on two frivolous complaints without conferring the rest of the board and bringing us in on that process. We were eliminated from the process. And as a citizen, I can't tolerate that. And as a representative, an elected official, I will stand up for the rest of this community when it comes to that as well. So that's where I'm at. I want to thank Paul Savas publicly for standing up for our right to function as a board, and for standing up to the commissioners in their efforts to rewrite these rules. So Paul Savas is on our side, and I just wanted to
those and all those who have violated our rights with insurance just by not filing paperwork. So let's not even go where I'm going to go, because I'm going. Okay, number one. Number two, some of the things he said about Latinos and women.
Where's Donald?
Thank you. He's next. Anyways, I just want y'all to know that I'm going to get down and find out the facts on every single one of our commissioners, starting with John Ludlow. Some things that he said, and I've watched the BBC or whatever the channel it is. I watched it three times, people, and he has said something about homeless people and these people, and how, you know, certain people are crooks. Just because they are who they are. I have a problem with this. A big problem, and I hope y'all do too, let alone, thank you very much, Mark Johnson, because it is taxation with representation, and Wendy Brown herself will make sure something happens about this, and I hope I have a whole lot of support, so thanks for letting me not even ask any questions. They're rhetorical, so thank you.
So we have some more questions.
Guys, I can't, you're gonna have to come up here. I can't step in front of that that amp, and I'm sorry.
Speak in Italian, Marcia, will you please?
I just wanted to reiterate, put quotes around or whatever you say about what Rick Applegate had to say. And I do believe that the county is after George. I believe that they were, for many reasons, probably they have, and who knows if it's right or wrong. But the problem with it that I have is that they took our right away as a community to elect who we wanted to our board. We couldn't even get to the May elections because they took away our board. And that's just not okay. Whether we as a group, as a community, elect certain board members or don't elect certain board members, that's our right to do that. That's our right to have a voice, and they've taken our voice away. We need to have the villages so we continue to have a voice, and we need to fight to do that. My suggestion about the next step to the gentleman in the U of O shirt is that a group, a very small group, 3 to 5 people who are quote unquote not biased toward the situation, go to the county and try to work with them and see what they need from us as a community. Let them know what we need from them to get this back rolling again, to get elections going again, to get a board established again. I think that George, unfortunately, is probably not one of the people that should go, because they have it out for him. And they're not going to listen to anything that he says. So that's my suggestion, is that a group, a small group of leadership from this community, go to the board and start the conversation.
Can I all speakers identify themselves?
Yeah, sorry. I'm Marcy Slater. I'm a former board member.
Thanks, Marcy.
And the gentleman in the U of O jersey is Tony Grant. You got it? Okay.
So I'm $450,000 of the lawsuits the county's been paying on. Just so you know. My name's Kip O'Connor. I don't think it's George and the commissioners. The fact of the matter is, they did it from a wall of two. I think the problem is that the county moves the goalposts. They don't like something, they shift them this way. You miss. And what they do is they actually hope that you just go away. You know? A lot of people will just go away. George didn't go away. Alala didn't go away. I'm still here, and I've been doing this for 6 years, fighting lawsuits against county commissioners. They just don't get it. And I'll tell you what's really funny. When you look out in this audience, you see no opposition. Raise your hands if you oppose the village's board.
That's coming.
Let's see it. Is there one? Okay, there's nobody. So that's the representation that's trying to take over our representation. And I find that really odd that not one person can come here and oppose this. So it's not just George, it's the DCC moving the goalposts, changing the rules, not following the ZDOs. A ZDO is a law. It takes you and me and everybody to vote to change a ZDO. It's not just the commissioners, it's not just the planning department. So having people here talking can stop that. Mr. Johnson can probably stop that. But the fact of the matter is, all the money the county's paid and puts forth an effort to either knock the village's board down, go after Sue Hanson, go after me. They haven't done things like represented us in simple ways. I don't know how many of you live on the river or in a floodplain, but Clackamas County spent $450,000 arguing with me over floodplain issue, and then they didn't pay attention to FEMA's rules. And then they lost every resident, homeowner, that is in a floodplain that gets a NFIP reduction. 20% county had since 2004. It was 25%. They didn't pay attention. So now we don't get that anymore. So if you're a person who pays flood insurance under the National Flood Insurance Program, and you've been getting a deduction of 20%, that's gone for 2 years at least. If you're not in a floodplain and you're paying a floodplain, a flood insurance thing, you lost 10% reduction for the next 2 years at least. So while the county fights George or me or just pays attention to someone else they don't want to dinner, they aren't doing their job. They cost the county residents $250,000 in insurance fees. Affected 1,540 residents, homeowners, more than that, residents. I think the fact that these guys keep paying so much attention to honest representation and trying to move the goalposts on us constantly has to stop. And unfortunately, you know, they're set 60, 70 people today. I think it needs to get, it just needs to be compounded. I don't think anybody understands what they do. It's not George, it's them. It's not Tip O'Connor, it's them. It's not Susan Hansen, it's them. And I don't think that anybody really gets that until they have just been put through the grinder. I'm being ground up, I'm still going for it. I expect him to do the same thing. And I expect our community to do the same thing. So.
Okay, Dad.
Thanks a lot, Kip.
Thanks, Kip. Thanks. Yeah, one of the other things that I probably should mention as well, I don't know whether you guys have paid attention to the 2017 road maintenance budget that has come out with Clackamas County. Now, I've been trying for 6 years to get our roads sorted out, bringing them back up to a normal standard. You know, I drove around, it took me 6 days, and I took a photo of all of our roads and the potholes and put together a PowerPoint presentation, and you know, still to no avail. I can't get it county to pay attention to us, but in this 2017 budget there is not 1 cent that is going to be spent up here on our roads. It's not budgeted. Now I know that all of you guys understand. It's not budgeted. We don't, I've been very I also have a nonprofit called the Mount Hood Bicycle Pedestrian Coalition. I've been working now for quite some time and trying to develop a bicycle pedestrian implementation plan so we can have safer cycling and pedestrian routes for our residents and visitors. But I can't, I've had no luck. Out of all of the roads in Clackamas County, the ones that are subjected to the most damage is our roads. We deal with the weather. We have all the big rigs, the chains, all the traffic that's been going up Lobo Pass Road, hauling this gravel from 26. Up Lobo Pass.
What did I say?
From 26 up Lobo Pass.
Oh, from 26 up Lobo Pass. Our roads are in horrible shape. From a cyclist standpoint, all those potholes are hazards. I can tell you that for a fact. 4 shoulder surgeries on this one, 1 on this one, riding my bike. But
Either way, we've been trying for, I've been trying, the coalition's been trying. We were responsible for starting the Clackamas County, actually came up, they got a grant to do a feasibility study on a valid bicycle pedestrian implementation plan. $180,000 grant. They recently met to talk about that. I have not had a chance to listen to that, so I'm very, very curious to see whether that is going to move forward or not, or whether the commissioners, because they know I'm behind it, are going to kibosh it. But we'll see. We'll see how that goes. But anyway, I want anybody else in the audience that has anything else to say or any questions?
Hey, George. One thing, take me about 30 seconds.
Sure. Gary Rand.
I've been watching this whole thing since they were putting the highway through here and widening it out and ignoring what we had as public input to say about how this widening was done. They've essentially taken away the autonomy of our communities up here, put a freeway through, and they could have put a boulevard, maybe a meandering little something to make people understand there's someplace. Instead of a five-lane freeway that's as straight as an arrow, the people just automatically want to just haul ass through, okay? And so the county, it's not about George. George is just a speed bump in this situation. They don't want us to have representation about how they spend our money that comes out of our community up here. They really don't want us getting in the way of their decision-making down there in Oregon City. There's nothing east of Oregon City in their minds except for a bunch of ignorant people and some sort of tax revenue this money keeps coming in from. And so ultimately it is just about them not wanting any community input from us out here about how this money is spent or how it's applied to our community in here. So that's all I wanted to say.
Thanks. Kurt?
Yeah.
I'm going to try to get as close to you as I can, but I've got to stay. Okay.
That's okay. Getting to be an old man. My name is Kurt Robinson. I'm an interim member of the board, but I'm also interested in running for a new board position when and if it comes available. I have one question mainly for Mark Johnson and for George, and that is, with all these atrocities that the county is doing and putting on us, what legal recourse do we have through the state legislature, through lawsuits, whatever? You know, sometimes people listen to a group when there's money involved. And I'd just like to ask you guys that question.
Mark, you want to go first?
Oh, careful.
Yeah, I don't want to tangle you up here.
I honestly don't know. I'd have to research that, but I should get their legislative counsel, the attorneys that work for the legislature in Salem, to research that. But I don't know what kind of recourse you might have for malpractice, if you will, as I think that's what you're coming up with. Maybe George has some ideas.
Ethics board.
Yeah, well, this is one of the reasons why we're recording this meeting. I wanted to make sure that I was able to cover my bases. We're putting together a package that we intend to put in front of the Oregon Attorney General, Oregon State Attorney General. I've got all my documentation in order. I don't know how long that process is going to take. I don't anticipate that's going to be something that happens in the near future. I'm talking about as far as them hearing the case or paying any attention to it until they can get around to it. But we need to go in line if that's what it takes. And I just want to tell everybody, I really have done my best to take the high road here and do what was best for the community in trying to move this process forward so that we could get back to a point where we could carry on elections and move forward with the board. Every step I have taken, I've been struck down by Clackamas County. Now, we've had 14 board member applications. 14, which is unheard of. I can remember being on the board where we had three vacant seats, four, I think, for a while. But we had three vacant seats for well over a year. So we've got people now who are willing to step forward, sit on the board, people from the community. Even then, they are blocking us from moving forward with elections and having the board. So, yeah, I just wanted to establish a clear pattern and let everybody know what was going on. I wanted you guys to hear it from me and from Carol and some of the other others of us who've been dealing with this. And I just wanted to make sure that you were informed, that you knew it was happening, and that you heard both sides of the story. So, is there anybody else? Ann?
Yeah.
Ann Holbrook.
Yeah, Ann Holbrook, and I am not a political person. I don't like politics. But Marcy Slater, who was up here earlier, I think she had a good idea, and I agree with her that some committee needs to be formed. And with all due respect to you, George, they don't like you. And maybe that does not include you. I don't know.
You're a diplomat, Anne.
What?
You're a diplomat.
Oh.
You're well, made for politics.
To me, it seems like we are just spinning our wheels on this whole thing. And you're talking about a litigious, I don't know, that you would go in the litigious direction, which would take months, years. And my question is there an alternative? I know that Rhodey has a CPO. I don't know if there could be a village's CPO where we just do our own thing.
Maybe an ombudsman for our little area to start.
Well, I don't know. The whole thing could be tied up for months and years, the way things go. So I just think we need to come up with an alternative, and if the BCC is absolutely against the village's board, or the village's, the village's board, then, you know, we just have to come up with something different. Instead of going to court, and, you know, hopefully all those people, maybe with the exception of Paul, and certainly the exception of you, Mark, are out of the BCC this year.
We've got some. Yeah, can you guys come up here to the mic so that we can all hear what you have to say, and then introduce yourself. I don't want to have you step over here because I don't want to step over.
Well, my name's Kyle. I moved up here 15 years ago. I'm super simple. 15 years ago, I go to the mountain. The mountain's like our home, we all go play there. 15 years ago, I used to have to hitchhike. I'm pretty sure this board had a whole lot to do with the Mountain Express, the Mountain Times, they talk about expanding the Mountain Express to include Meadows. $30,000 a year is the extra cost. I'm sure Meadows would kick down something. But like these little things that involve me, like this is my daily transportation to and from work. I no longer have to stand on the side of the road and hitchhike. I mean, simple things. Do these people not think we vote? This village, it does something, and I just want to see it do more.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Just a simple question. Have they put forth any sort of resolution? They dissolve us, but have they said, this is what you need to do?
No. Not yet. No, they're pretty focused on trying to get rid of me. Yes. I struggled with this actually, because I could have just walked away. I could have just walked away and probably things would have moved on. But if I would have walked away, I'd be giving up my rights. And this community would be giving up their rights. There's a process that's in place to deal with these. And as I said at the beginning of the meeting, all I'd ever asked is that we all play on the same field, that the rules are the same for the county as they are for us. It's the only way it works. It's the only way it works. So yeah, the county is definitely upset at me. I am, as they described, a burr under their saddles because this has been going on for so long. And I've been holding them accountable.
Good on you.
And that's just what we all have to do. We have to hold our elected officials accountable.
That's what he should.
You know, they work for us. They work for us. We are a cash cow for Clackamas County. Clackamas County comes up here, they log our trees, and all the money goes to Clackamas County, or excuse me, to Oregon City. We get nothing. Room taxes. Listen, we are losing a lot of money as a community up here. And yes, we need to have representation. I just want to say one thing again, and it was mentioned earlier in the meeting about the differences between our board and a CPO. CPOs are a completely different board. They deal with land use issues. They deal with land use issues. And our village's board was designed and set up to be an advisory board to Clackamas County. Now, an advisory board, that's a two-way street, supposed to be. I kind of got tired of relaying all the information from Clackamas County to the village residents, but they weren't willing to listen to the village residents when we went to Clackamas County to give them our concerns. So yeah, I got a little upset after 8 years as a director and not being paid attention to. So I'm going to pass this off. I know you're up here for a question too, aren't you?
No, I just come up here to give you a call.
Yeah, I'm glad you came.
Hi, everyone. My name is Greg Estes, resident for 21 years up here in the mountain. And I see our representation is here tonight, our people that support the community, and our county commissioners are not. But my question is, I voted for Paul Savas. I believe in Paul Savas. I like what he stands for. And I wonder, the question is, I guess, more to George, was he personally invited here, or was it just a letter to just all the commissioners? And has anybody approached Paul Savas to give us, hold on, let me finish, to personally explain why they're doing this? And do you think he will answer those questions? That's my question.
Yeah, thank you.
He could be here now answering them.
Okay, I'll get you. I'll get there. I too personally spoke with Paul Savas a couple of times, and Paul relayed to me that he wished that he could be here, but he had a previous speaking engagement that he had, so he wasn't able to make it. He was the only commissioner that responded. So yeah, and I think you spoke with Paul as well too, didn't you, John?
Nothing in writing or email other than I just couldn't be here.
Yeah, I sent a personal email to Paul Savas.
I pronounced it wrong.
I sent a personal email to Paul Savas, and so he would be here. It's just that he had a previous engagement, so somebody over here. Yeah.
Paul Savas did come and talk to the Women's Club for their monthly meeting this month, and he was very sad that he could not come tonight. It was just a conflict. I think he spoke well of the village's board. He carefully chose his words of his frustration and challenges of being on the commissioner board and what happened. I personally was at the meeting that they did their 180 degree turn at the last board meeting. The shock, I guess, in his face was the same as mine, because after reading the recommendation from, what's the council? Lisa.
Katie Wilson.
They were really recommending that the board just redo the election. And when the item came up on the agenda, the entire board, except for Paul, agreed. And I'm sure you've all heard that, so I'm not going to go over it all, but it was quite shocking.
Yeah, but the question is why? Has anybody asked him why?
He is not at liberty to
He won't go into it because he's afraid he's going to piss off everybody else in the commissioners.
No, I think he's a professional, and I think he is an intelligent professional trying to do his job representing all of us. That's what I saw. Okay. That's what I saw, and I think that the Women's Club would agree that that's the way he conducted himself at our meeting. I don't agree. Miss Marilyn, come on up here.
Oh, I'll be done.
George.
Larry was here.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you. And Larry Berteau, our editor of the Mountain Times.
Oh, shucks, come on. The question was asked earlier, what can we do? I have been voiced in the wilderness for 8 years. I come out of the wilderness once again to remind you, you start gathering signatures to incorporate and you'll get the county's attention.
Thank you, Larry.
That's a biggie.
Yeah.
My name is Marilyn Anderson. I've been a resident here for 22 years full time and 14 years before that. So I feel like I have quite a few roots in this community and a lot of good friends. But my plan, I think this has been going on in my mind for some time. We do need representation at the county level. And if George has 14 board member willing people who would want to be on the board, let's get them on the board. Let's vote on a new coordinator or director of that board. Let's start something different. We can go by the guidelines of the villages. I have a manual for that, and the county has put together. We could use those guidelines and start our own community organization. And I think we could make a difference in this county and in this community by doing so. Anyway, are there any questions that anyone not necessarily. We could use their guidelines and we could invite them in. But I don't know that, you know, if we want to be on their villages or their hamlets organization, we'd have to be under their jurisdiction, and they did give us a couple $1,000s a year operating expenses, but I think we could raise those funds too on just a weekend of work by all of us in some fashion. But I sure would like to see a community organization that comes together and diplomatically takes in all the problems that each one of us might have with the community and finds some solutions. and not just talk about it.
So I would like to highlight a little bit on what was just said with regard to another organization, establishing another organization, and it's completely possible. We could even start a nonprofit, our own nonprofit, and start working in that capacity. And you know, we already have established relationships with other agencies, with Travel Oregon, with ODOT, with, you know, all of these people still recognize us, and we have a great relationship with them. Our problem right now is, it's a few commissioners, two commissioners specifically, but we deal with that by voting. When it's right now, we've got an election coming up in November. The only one on the commission that's up for election is Tootie Smith, and she's running against Ken Humberston. I highly suggest voting for Ken Humberston. Tootie Smith is certainly not serving our needs, never has, and I'm able to say this because we're not operating under Village's rules now. This is a citizen forum, and we can endorse whoever we want and say what we want. So, I'm opposed to Tootie Smith, and I hope that you guys will join me in helping to vote in Ken Humberston. But either way, that's an option. A nonprofit organization is certainly an option. I think that this board is important to save. I think it's it's 10 years. We've done an incredible amount. I mean, I don't want to throw away the baby with the bathwater. You know, I want to set a precedence with Clackamas County that we are here and that we deserve to be respected. And that's all. That we are a valid organization, and that we be treated with respect, just like they want us to treat them with respect. Rick?
I just want to point out, in the end, in the end, we have to be effective with the county. They govern our community. And so whatever solution that we come up with, we have to be effective, or have the possibility to be effective with the county. We need them, they need us. And we have to turn this around somehow. We start with Paul Savas, then we start with Paul Savas. He sent me an email this morning. He wished he could be here, but he had other engagements. He talked to our representatives, he talked to many people in the community, okay? One of the things that we have to be absolutely on target with is understand that the commissioners believe that they have adequate communication with our community. If you listen to the tapes, you'll hear them say, the Chamber of Commerce represents us up here. They feel that. The Chamber of Commerce does a lot of really good things. They're a pay-to-play organization. They represent their members. They don't represent the seniors. They don't represent our community. Well, any other issues that are really important to this community, okay? So I think that whatever mode we use to try and organize and to try and get on top of things, we have to understand that we have to have some ability at some point to be effective with our commissioners, just as we have to be effective with all the other organizations, whether it's ODOT or anybody else. And so, we don't want a toothless lion. You know, we want to be strong, and we want to be able to have some way to do that. But relationship with commissioners at some point is an absolute critical must.
How do you do that?
All right. So this is how you do this. The village's board is set up under the guidelines of the Clackamas County. Unfortunately, I don't read anything in there that says hiatus.
Put the mic up to your mouth.
There is no word that describes putting a village's board on hiatus in the ZDOs. Nothing that recognizes a hamlet or villages says the county commissioners have the right to put us on hiatus. Sorry, but I think that we got some bad advice, because after the village's board had that issue, we had like 45 days, I forget, I didn't pay attention before coming here, to actually vote in the people that they say were not at the board. We could have had another emergency meeting, we could have voted for people on the board, and we could have put it in their face. I'm not sure of the legality of doing that today, but it's in the bylaws. That's what we're allowed to do. We don't have to listen to the BCC board. Rick, I applaud you for wanting to work with them, but unfortunately they're not working with us. So the first thing to do is to hold an emergency meeting, screw the county if they don't recognize us, have an emergency village board meeting, have an election. Mr. Robert or Johnson here could come and witness it. Why not? Have a board meeting, have an election, and then when the county doesn't recognize us or they want to dissolve us, they're doing something totally illegal. We don't have to come up with money for that. We have to go to the Attorney General and say, look what the county is doing to us. So we don't have to do a lot of stuff. The bylaws already created a way for us to be recognized in spite of what the county commissioners want to do. If everybody wants to read it, you can go on the ZDO board, look up villages and hamlets, and it says it right there. That's why they're trying to dissolve us, because it's not in their bylaws. It's not in the ZDOs, so they're changing the goalposts. That's how you change it. Have another meeting, elect a board, have a representative there, and the county can't do nothing. You can keep going to their meetings, and you can put it in their face. That's what I think should be done.
Okay. Is there anybody else that has anything to say? Peter Cox.
Okay. Peter Kakesh, I live here for 28 years, and I just want to add something because it's coming up in the election. Not just the budget for next year for roads that doesn't consider our community is on a you just mentioned budget, but there is going to be a vote for tax increase, for gas tax increase in Clackamas County. So consider that vote when you're checking it out, that zero is being made done in the next year, the next 2 years in our community, okay? I watched for 20 years the nonsense on La Lopez Road, I lived there, and when they come up and they re-strike the road, 3 weeks later, they come back and they repave portion of the road, and a month later they come and restripe it again. They don't need more money, they just need a common sense and effectiveness.
Thank you, Peter. I couldn't have said it better myself.
Also, the...
Come on, use the mic.
Yeah. When you're voting, the other thing that's happening in the county is that we are electing a new chair for their board. And if you like Ludlow, or you know, whatever other options you might find appropriate. I think there's a couple of the commissioners that are running for that position.
Vote for George.
Yeah.
Go kick some butt.
God, don't make me dream about that. Yeah. Is there anybody else that, Jim? I also would like to mention, and J-
just for the video, that I'm fortunate enough to know almost everybody's name in here. So I made a comment at our last board meeting that we had we had over 200 people at that board meeting, and I had made a comment at that time because it was asked, you know, where everybody came from, and I made a comment saying, these are my friends. They're my family and my friends. I have never lived anywhere more than 5 years ever in my life until I moved to this mountain. I've been here now 17. So I feel proud about my community. I love the people in it. That's why I've been here for 17 years. And I just have to stand up for what's right. And that's where I'm at. I am a very driven individual. I've been a volunteer all my life, all my adult life, and I take offense to my community service and my service to my country being taken of light, you know, by Clackamas County, and the misquotes and deliberate misquotes. So yeah, I have a personal issue, but my main concern is what happens with this community. I really want you guys to understand it. And that's why I ended up going through the mediation process. That was a $2,500 bill out of my pocket, you know, to have the opportunity to go in front of the BCC to go through the mediation and then have an agreement and then have it struck down. So, again, I can't tell you how many times I've been, no matter what angle I go, I've been shut down by Clackamas County. And I just wanted my shot to be able to inform you guys. Jim? Yes, I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm Jim Callentine. I've only been up here for 6 years, and I've heard a lot about the voting and and getting people out there and creating a board. I've worked for the city of Portland, Sherwood, Fairview, Woodburn, basically GIS infrastructure mapping. I was on the CPO for Happy Valley before that got incorporated. I was on the Planning Commission for Happy Valley to basically stop development in Happy Valley. Well, you see how that one worked. The whole thing is, there's, you know, it's a process that really, in a way, is going to happen. The one thing I was looking at when we talked about the boards, George and I mentioned this a couple of times, is you don't have to be 50, 60, 70, 80 years old to be on this board. You can be 20 and 30 years old. Younger people to get up there. This is your community that's coming up the line. So you people need to be out there. The younger people need to be out there. You know, and I know you're out there going, oh wow, I went up there and the snow, I had my tongue out and I got snow and snowboarding's coming up and I don't have time. Well, you know, it's like usually one dime a month. You know, you're there at 6, out by 8, music starts at 9, you know, you're good to go. So younger people, come on out there and run for one of these positions. One, a group that would be more of a non-political group, 20s and 30-year-olds, come on out there, be part of that group that some people have mentioned to go down to the county. You know, be part of that. You know, so like I said, it's, you know, yeah, you're working jobs, you're working two jobs, you know. God, you just had your 13th kid. Okay, you don't have to run. But anyway, you could, you know, younger people need to get involved in this thing to make sure that this is your community also, and you're the one bringing it up.
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Jim, for bringing that up. And yes, Jim and I have talked about this on multiple occasions, and I've had this conversation with many people throughout the community, especially our what I refer to as our young adults. I've been a very, very strong advocate to getting our young adults involved in the local political scene. And we did. We did. Our election, the election that we had, you know, we elected one of our community residents, Ben Bleasner, young adult, you know, he's got a family of his own and has lived here all of his life, you know, in his 30s, and he was willing to step up to the plate. That was the election that was invalidated by Clackamas County. And it all started from there. And so we have a situation where you know, we have plenty of people that want to sit for this board. And Clackamas County refuses to let us move forward. So at this time, if there aren't any more questions, I want to move forward and get to a vote on this issue, and we can adjourn, and I can let Mark let Mark get back to his home in Hood River.
Highway 35.
So, if anybody has not filled out one of the documents that I have up there in order to dispute Clackamas County's intentions to move forward with the dissolution process, or, and most importantly, to change county code to allow the BCC, the Board of County Commissioners, to remove an elected board member if they feel that that board member is not suiting the needs of the county. So that's the document. If you guys have not signed that, if you could, please sign it. And there's a little basket up there on the table there that you can put it in. I'll be collecting these. They're not, they don't have to be finished up to date, but I sent copies out on our Facebook page. I also sent copies out to everybody on my email list. So, if you'd like to be added to the email list, I would appreciate you guys signing in. It's very important that you guys sign in, please. And don't just sign in with your name. Please put your address down so that your vote can be counted. I am really trying to cover all my bases. I'm going to do this via a document. I'm also going to call for a vote and by a show of hands. We've got it on video. I want the county to bear witness to what the community wishes to do in moving forward with the board. And so I think that we'll be able to cover our bases that way. So if there aren't any more questions, you got a question?
Do I really need to vote?
Yes.
I just want to...
Hey, y'all. My name is Linda Estes. And
come over here.
I just want to know if we can take those forms and have other people sign.
Yes.
It.
Yes.
Or you mentioned email. Mm-hmm. If we can send it out to people we know. Yes. And have them somehow fill it out, print it out. Okay. So that's all. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anybody, if you have friends or neighbors, I really try to get as many people notified on this as possible. You know, part-time homeowners and, you know, as many residents as possible. But if you guys want to be included in any information that comes from the villages, certainly leave your email address and I will add you to our contact list. So, no more questions? Well, our next step right now is to present the BCC with our documentation. We will distribute this video. It's going to be distributed via social media. We want this, I want this to go countywide. I want Clackamas County to bear witness to what we're talking about, what we're dealing, what our concerns are, and then see where we go. I don't know what Clackamas County is going to do next. You know, I can't answer that question. But what I can do is to stand up for our rights as citizens and, you know, force Clackamas County to play by the same rules that we play by. It's the only thing I know how to do. So, Regina.
Thank you, George. Well, I'm Regina Lithgow, homeowner, realtor, president of Hoodland Women's Club. And, I believe we need a leader, someone who's currently on the Mountain of Villages board, to take us to the county. And if they won't come to us, we should go to them. And I'd be willing to go myself. I am in support of having the Mountain of Villages. I believe we need a strong representation up on the mountain. And I got to hand it to the Rhododendron CPO for the glue they have to keep themselves together as a planning organization. We used to have a very strong one with Welch's CPO. And, you know, these kind of organizations shouldn't go by the wayside. We have a lot of working class families up here on the mountain. They're not high income earners. People do work two jobs. People don't even get full-time work up here. And I know it's important to have a voice to let the county know our needs up here. And I support the Mountain Villages. I support the board that's current, and I'd like to see more people participate. Thank you.
Thanks, Regina. Okay.
George?
Yeah.
I move that if we as a community determine to not dissolve
yes.
the villages of Mount Lebanon.
Yeah.
Second.
Okay. I'd like to, and Rick's motion is to vote to not dissolve the village's board. And I'm in total agreement with that, and that's why we're here. I would like to call for a vote right now by a raise of hands.
You step in front of that thing, dude.
Yeah, I know. I'd like to call for a vote by a raise of hands from community members here. And I want to be very, I want to use my words very clear, be very clear with my words. All those who oppose the BCC's actions to dissolve the village's board and or move forward in changing county code to arbitrarily remove an elected board member. All those who are opposed to this, raise your hands. Okay, I want to make sure that's on video. And it looks like it's pretty unanimous from my viewpoint. Okay. All those who are in favor of the dissolution process from the village's board, or the dissolution of the village's board, raise your hands. We have no one. It's a unanimous decision, and thank you. I want to thank you guys for your support, and I hope to send this very clear message to Clackamas County that we are all in alignment. I appreciate everybody behaving themselves. Yeah, nobody was out of line, and yeah, we didn't give Clackamas County any excuses to, you know, any more excuses to come up with. So, thank you, everybody. Unless there's anything more anybody else has to say, I'm going to adjourn this meeting and let everybody go home. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.